Another round with Lee Strobel, as he claims his second interviewee will give evidence for the legitimacy of the New Testament once again. Will it be enough to make me reconvert? Stay tuned and we'll see what this interviewee has to offer. So Lee Strobel's second interview, which he used for his book, The Case for Christ, in showing the legitimacy of the New Testament and Christ's resurrection, was with Dr. Bruce Metzger, who is now long deceased. Now, you can accuse Lee Strobel of a lot of things, but you can't accuse him of picking people who aren't educated. For the late Dr. Metzger certainly was. Dr. Metzger had a master's from the Theological Seminary of Princeton, as well as a PhD. He's written or edited 50 books regarding the accuracy of the New Testament. He was a scholar of the Tyndale House in England, and he has sat on multiple chairs of biblical archaeology. Like Craig Blumberg, the man was highly, highly educated and highly, highly regarded. Anyone studying the New Testament is going to come across his name for sure. However, he was also a minister in the Presbyterian Church, which of course leads to the belief in the infallibility of the Bible as well. And like all of Lee Strobel's interviewees, that's going to lead to a bias towards his faith. But Lee's main question to Dr. Metzger, how can we confirm the authenticity of the New Testament, especially the Gospels, when we not only have no originals of these Gospels, but nothing but copies from copies from copies, as he states in the chapter of this book. And Dr. Metzger gives his best shot. First, he states because of the multiplicity of the copies, in other words, the amount of volume that was actually produced. He says, regarding the New Testament, we have over 5,000 Greek manuscripts, 8,000 to 10,000 manuscripts in the Latin Vulgate, and over 8,000 others from other regions. His argument being that no amount of volume has ever been produced, including even works such as Homer's Iliad. And in fairness, that's a good point. As early Christianity spread from country to country, region to region, I cannot find any other religion, including Islam, that has this amount of volume written about it. But that doesn't necessarily mean that the story is true. And it's also going to be argued that these manuscripts had many, many variations. For one of Bruce Metzger's students, which I didn't know this until the making of this video, was the highly regarded biblical scholar Bart Ehrman. And Bart Ehrman was once a fundamentalist. He considered Bruce Metzger a mentor to him. And Mr. Ehrman has stated that one of the key factors that led him to agnosticism was the fact that with all these manuscripts that didn't agree with each other, he couldn't see accuracy in the New Testament on any level where he could consider it as a whole reliable. But when something becomes the new religion, and then becomes the state religion of something like the Roman Empire, as it did in 380 AD, and then bishops are placed all over the region in the semi-civilized world to propagate this religion, it makes sense that a great deal of volume of works would be produced. I can see Dr. Metzger's point, but I can't really correlate that as evidence, considering how much this religion became part of many governments who authoritatively propagated it. Now, a second argument was because such a short time elapsed between Christ's crucifixion and these writings of the New Testament, that there really wasn't much time to change the outline of the story. And again, I'm going to say that doesn't mean the story was true. For instance, I recently discovered that the oldest text we have of the Quran is over 1,300 years old. That takes us approximately to 700 AD, give or take a few years. Muhammad supposedly had his revelation in 610 AD. And Muhammad, according to the writings, supposedly ascended into heaven back to Allah on a winged horse. And you will note the many miraculous things that Allah bestowed upon him. And this text was written in a very short time after Muhammad's revelation, but again, it doesn't make it true. And then Dr. Metzger states that because there's many varying languages of the story of Christ, and with all these different tongues, they seem to have a common theme, therefore the story must be legitimate. Well, I see that there's many discrepancies. For let's take the Old Testament, the prophecy of Isaiah, where the ancient Hebrew word for the woman who is to bear Emmanuel actually meant woman or young woman, and was later mistranslated into the word virgin. And there's many variations in the New Testament as well. Many of them are minor, some aren't. But the Gospels themselves contradict each other, specifically on how Christ portrays himself. As in the Gospel of John, he is very much portrayed as divine, but Matthew, Mark, and Luke not so much so. And then, of course, Lee Strobel asked the question of powerful men changing the Bible. Now, Bruce Metzger's contention is that these early church bishops were looking over the books of the Bible very carefully and only would keep them in if they were congruent. In other words, if somebody wrote an offbeat version of Christ, which didn't seem to fit with the mainstream account of him, that book was usually tossed. And that contention does make some sense. Now, Bruce Metzger would like to believe that these bishops had the best interest of the world and were seeking for a congruity of truth of who Christ actually was in their faith. And that's kind of my end point. That is their faith. I guarantee they weren't willing to see things in that slow canonization of the Bible from other written works that didn't match their faith. And I guarantee they wanted to appear solid in their foundation because the role of the bishop had transformed from the clergy of the church to a political figure acting directly with government. Dr. Metzger is giving an awful lot of assumption in the canonization of the books of the Bible. And at the end of the interview, Dr. Metzger states that there was no doubt that these books came down as written. And you have to understand that he is saying this with a bias of someone who, if isn't an evangelist per se, is a very close carbon copy of one who believes in the infallibility of the Bible and is not going to be convinced otherwise, regardless of his education and accolades. And he quotes the late F.F. Bruce of also agreeing with the fidelity of the New Testament. And F.F. Bruce was an evangelist who would not believe otherwise, even if it was laid out in front of him with concrete fact. And my question to Lee Strobel is, why did you just accept these contentions of Dr. Metzger without going to a skeptic's viewpoint? I don't know if Bart Ehrman had gained status as a biblical scholar yet in 1980, but there were others who were. At least Dr. Metzger didn't state untruths like Lee Strobel's previous interview with Craig Blumberg, and I'm not saying that his points on the authenticity of the New Testament couldn't be valid. I'm just saying that's naive to assume that his points do close the argument, especially in an era where bishops were being linked with emperors like Constantine, and Christianity was indeed becoming political. As a matter of fact, soon it would be authoritative on people's lives. So I'm waiting for that day when Strobel actually goes and interviews an opposite opinion. Because as of right now, in his book The Case for Christ, we have two interviews, and neither of them seem to be objective at all. But if you'd like to read a tale that has nothing to do with objective, check out my novel The Second Fall, an offbeat apocalypse sure to offend the fundamentalist, on Amazon. See the link in the video description below, as well as the banner. And I will see you next time as we once again take that sword of reason and reality and thrust it right through the heart of ignorance.